here at Liberty Ash, the home service department is a very important part of the marketing effort, okay, for Liberty. She'll tell you a little bit about that. She's a certified home economist. She's a graduate of Cape Girardeau, Southeast Missouri State, and she's been with Liberty for 9 years. And she really gives a terrific presentation. Take notes, pay attention, because in 2 weeks you need to do a demonstration like this, okay? So listen up and pay attention. Notice the way she moves, the kinds of scripting that she uses for herself, and what she tells you about how to relate to your audience and so forth, okay? Becky does this all day long. She's a total professional, so take advantage and learn a lot, okay? And she hates the camera, so she's doing us a favor by letting me take this, or letting Sue take this, I should say. So be real nice to her because she's not happy about the camera, okay?
Well, I'll just build in my excuse. She just talked me up and said I do a great job, but since I have a camera on me today, I may not do such a great job. Do you actually videotape the presentations?
Every single one, yes. Okay. And then they play them back and evaluate themselves in private, and we do a public evaluation among all of us.
Okay.
So every single thing we do, we videotape. Yeah.
In my techniques class, we had to do the same thing. So I never did like the camera. I don't think anyone likes the camera. It's hard to see yourself and think, ooh, that's what I really look like, or that's what I really sound like. So anyway, I do want to welcome all of you to Liberty, and you heard a little bit about my background, and I just want to kind of find out what areas you all are coming from. So if we could kind of go around the room here.
Oh, Margaret Jones, early childhood education.
Okay.
I'm a family of professional merchandise.
My name is Leanne, I'm a dietetic.
I'm going to be more than fashion.
Okay. I'm Donna, I'm fashion merchandising.
I'm Jules, and I'm fashion merchandising.
And I'm Sue Waller, and I'm in dietetics.
Great. Okay, great. Well, thanks for coming. And I want to start just by, like I said, welcoming you to our Shrewsbury Service Center. Our main office is downtown at 720 Olive. And basically, this is one of our work locations. Most of our service people work out of this location. But we have this little wing here for our marketing group because we have a lot of demonstrations and things that take place here. Consumer education really fits the name that's better for our department, and most people understand more what consumer education is. We have Girl Scouts come in, we help them earn some of their badges. We will work with different clubs and organizations, and even the general public will come in, and we will do the live cooking demonstrations to help promote the gas range and the gas grill. We also do energy programs, and we give tours of the service center and talk to them a little bit more about natural gas and that type of thing. So that's kind of a little bit about what I do. It kind of varies every day. And like I said, we do work with all the different age groups. And how many of you have actually cooked on gas before? About half of you. Okay. Madeline asked that I tell just a little bit about natural gas. Natural gas is a fossil fuel. There are actually three fossil fuels. We'll get into a little science here. Natural gas is a vapor. Oil is your liquid, and coal is your solid. And it is a very safe form of energy, and it's also a very efficient form of energy. As far as cooking with your gas range, it's 2-4 times more efficient than your electric. And I know a lot of times when you're looking at appliances, we tend to look at the dollar price and say, okay, this appliance is costing so much, we don't think about the operating cost. And it's important to think about those operating costs too, because that is going to affect your utility bill that you're going to be paying from month to month. And you know, usually though, when you're purchasing things, you're thinking of just what you have to spend up front, but you can get your money back. If a gas range may cost a little bit more, you're going to get that money back in what you save on your utility bills. So think about those, and as far as any appliance goes, think about the operating cost. And a lot of them have little energy guides on the appliances now too, so you can see what kind of energy that it's going to take for those appliances. But with the gas range, I actually grew up with electric. I grew up out in Washington, Missouri, and we didn't have gas out there. It's out there now. We've expanded westward with the natural gas. And so the first time I had exposure to cooking with natural gas was in college in my lab. And it was a lot different. And at first I was like, ooh, I don't know about this because it just looks so different. But it's really, I cannot cook with electric anymore. And I don't say that just because I work for the gas company, but because my mom still has the electric range. And I tend to burn things. And close with the gas when I'm doing my demonstration too. But the biggest difference, I think, has to do with the top burners, where you'll notice the biggest difference because you have that instant response. You know, you turn that flame on, your heat is instantly there. And they used to tease me because if I would have something that's about ready to boil over, those of you that are cooked with electric or still cooking with electric, you know, you have to move that pan. And you tend to spill things and you burn yourself, whatever. But with the gas range, all you have to do is turn the knob off and the boiler goes down instantly because your heat source is instantly gone. And I would be back here testing recipes behind here. We have a test kitchen. And I would move the pan over and spill it. You're like, what are you doing? And so well, it's about ready to boil over. And I'm like, well, just turn the knob off. I'm like, oh, this is really neat. So, I mean, it is a difference. And I'm used to that heat source being gone. So if I'm helping mom at home, you know, I'll turn something off. And then, oops, it kind of burnt because I didn't move the pan. So that's the biggest difference I noticed with cooking with gas versus electric. But everyone does have their preference. We prefer that people choose gas, of course. You do have to, it's nice if you can at least try both before you really make a decision when you get into your own homes or whatever, so that you at least get education on both sources. Does anyone have any questions so far? Okay, well, today we are here to learn about doing demonstrations, and you have not done a demonstration yet, is that correct? Okay. We're going to learn about doing demonstrations and using an assistant. And a lot of work does go into doing presentations. My presentations generally are food related, so some of these techniques will still apply with the early childhood or with fashion merchandising. So you can keep that in mind, and I'll try to kind of give hints as to those areas too. But keep in mind, most of my experience is with food, so I'm sorry, but I'll probably be referring to that most of the time. I do want to mention just a little bit about the stage too. Some of you may end up going into education or even like with dietetics. I know a lot of the hospitals have dietitians that actually do food demonstrations now where they're talking about healthy techniques or different cooking techniques. So if you are involved in any stage setups or even in designing the classroom and that type of thing, you always want to think about where the focus is on stage. And generally it's the center. So obviously our mirror and our island are in the center of the stage. So then after that point, after that's your main focal point, after that we read left to right, and that's the way people tend to look at the stage. So you'll notice we put their gas ovens on the left side because people are going to notice the appliances first and then they'll go over here. And we don't want to think about these electric appliances over here. We have our refrigerator. We pretend those don't exist, but we know we need that. So anyway, but you read left to right, so think about that when you're setting up your stage. Also, if you're going to be using any props, for instance, we did a program on Thai cuisine. It has some more unusual food items, such as the lemongrass and coconut milk and some of those things. We set up a little display table showing some of those different items. And so when people are coming in, it kind of gets their mindset on what we're going to be talking about, but then we're also using that left to right. We're looking at that first and kind of getting an idea of what's going to happen for our program. So when you're setting up your displays, especially fashion merchandising, there tends to be a lot of display. Think about the focal point. You know, when you look at a display window, when you look at it, what do you see first? You know, so what are the people really going to see first? And then remember that we read left to right. So, you know, think about that when you're positioning things. Okay, then after enough about the stage. After that, you need to come up with your theme or your speech or your purpose. And I think a lot of times the theme is the hardest thing, trying to decide on the topic. Probably all of you have been assigned to do a presentation or a demonstration, and the first thing is like, oh, what can I demonstrate? So once you find that, once you decide on your topic, then things start to fall into place. But think about what your goal is or what your purpose is, what you really want to do. And for us, our goal is always to promote the use of natural gas. So that's a given for us. So we know what our goal is. And then we have to think of exciting ways to promote that, because when you talk about natural gas, it's not the most exciting topic. You look at these gas ranges over here, it's like, oh, how can we spruce that up? And so when people, you're going to tell somebody, oh, I'm going to do a gas range presentation. You know, who's going to be first in line to come here about gas range? I mean, I'm not even we pick different food topics, and that's what entices the people to come. And then when we get them here, then we talk to them about some of the things about the natural gas and about the range and that type of thing. So, like I said, food is a big draw for people, so that's the way we can talk about the gas range and make it exciting. So, come up with your topic. You're going to have to write your speech, and I will write my speech out completely, and then I start making note cards. And I draft one of our files. We keep a file on our different programs because sometimes we will reuse the program for different clubs or organizations. So we tend to keep a file. And like here is a copy of the speech. We just write the speech out. And then I like to use this. Not everybody has to kind of find what works for them as far as preparing for a demonstration. But this is one of my handouts that I actually had from my techniques class in college. And it basically has different columns. It has your action or your task that you're going to do, your chatter, what you're going to talk about, and then any of your preliminary preparations or your equipment that you would need. And I kind of start in mind what I do now is I basically put my task in my chatter. And I have a sheet here. Task and then what I'm going to talk about. So, like on this one, this was a barbecue chicken pizza that we were demonstrating on our gas grill. And we were actually smoking the pizza on the grill too, so we had to make a foil pack. So my first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to make a foil pack, and then while I'm doing that, I'm talking about different types of wood chips that you can use. I'm talking about different things with the grill. Next, I'm going to top my crust with the sauce and the onion and the cheese and the chicken. And so I have like little tidbits about different kinds of crust that you can use, about the red onion, about the Gouda cheese. We use the smoked Gouda cheese, so I kind of talk about that a little bit. And then that's how I kind of organize my thoughts. Then from there, we make little note cards that you can put on your trays. Just kind of pass those around. And basically, it's that task and chatter again, but it's in a short form. Is in more of an outline form. And we also make tray cards. And you'll see I have my trays up here. These are kind of what the tray cards look like. We started laminating our cards because most of you know when you're preparing things at home, you kind of splash things around and your recipes get messed up. So we started laminating them so we could wipe them off easily. But the tray cards are a way to organize also and get things planned ahead of time. Because when it gets down to the wire and you're closer to your actual presentation time, your nerves start to kick in, and our people are coming in and kind of talking with you and asking questions and that type of thing. So you don't have a lot of time for the last minute setup. It gets kind of chaotic. So the tray cards are an easy way to make sure that you're organized and you have everything on hand. So I can go and look at my tray real quick and say, okay, I have my aluminum foil, I have my onion, I have my chicken, I have my barbecue sauce. And you just check right down your tray card, and it just kind of makes you feel easier instead of sitting there looking at your recipe and thinking, oh, we have everything here. Or if you're demonstrating how to give a baby bath or something like that, because you don't have my soap or washcloth. So these tray cards can apply to other things too. It doesn't necessarily have to be just for food items. So that's how we tend to organize our thoughts here. Backing up to the speech, all of us know from our composition classes, you basically have three parts to your speech. You have your introduction, which is very important because those are the first words that your people are going to hear. And you want to make it something catchy. You can use statistics, you can do a question, get them thinking, you can use the display, kind of like what we did, like I told you, what we did with the Thai cuisine, where we have a display table of the different food items. And lemongrass and that type of thing because it gets people in the mindset of the program. You could use a joke if you're a good joke teller. Add that. Some people, you know, just can't tell a joke. And also, if you're going to use a joke, make sure that it relates to your topic somehow. You don't want to just get up there and tell a joke and everybody laughing and then you start talking about your speech and you're way over here because then your audience is going to sit there and why did she say that? Or why did she tell that joke? What does it have to do with anything? So if it's it's a related joke and you're a good joke teller, go ahead and use that because it is kind of a fun way to start a program. Otherwise, like I said, fascinating facts, questions, those types of things. And you can look back to your some of your English comp things to come up with other ideas there. Then your body, obviously, is the most important, or the heart of your speech. That's where you're going to have all your information that you want to get out. And then your conclusion is the last part. And again, your conclusion, remember, those are the last words that people are hearing. So you may want to recap something. You may want to, if you started with a question, end with the answer, or what you think the answer should be. So, or you can end with a joke even, again, as long as it's related. So just remember, though, that you want your ending to be catchy also, because those are the words that people are really want. Okay, then, as I said, we do all of our preparation from our speech. We make our note cards, our tray cards, and that type of thing. And I do want to say, even though we write our speech out, never memorize your speech. And I'm sure all of you have heard that. And the reason you do not want to memorize is because it does not allow for panic. Or if something goes wrong, then panic does set in, and here you are with your memorized speech, and your food's not getting done, and I don't have anything else to say. So it doesn't allow for the unexpected if you memorize. What you do memorize, though, or what I try to memorize, is that what my task is and what I'm talking about. Like, I know when I'm mixing that marinade together, I'm going to be talking about what the purpose of marinades are and why we use marinades and that type of thing. So I just kind of know, like, with what my task is and what topic I'm going to be talking about, but I don't have it all written out. And I know when I'm doing my shrimp, that's a broiler recipe, so I'm going to be talking about broiling technique and that type of thing. So you memorize that part of it, or you kind of memorize an outline, but don't try to memorize word for word, because things do go wrong. And probably my biggest horror story was my first demonstration was I actually had a fire. So you can always doing your first presentation. So we were doing an appetizer program, and we were doing top runner appetizers, oven appetizers, and boiler appetizers, and the three of us were taking turns. Each one of us were doing a different part of the range, and I was doing top runner appetizers, and I was doing fried cheese, and I was with a lemon sauce. It was really good. But we had a plate with a paper towel on it sitting a little too close to the burner. And the corner of the paper towel caught on fire. So it was panic for a second, and what was kind of funny about it was that at the time I was making the lemon sauce, and my assistant was kind of finishing up frying the cheese, and I was just at the point where I was talking about the blue flame and how you want to have a blue flame because that's the most efficient flame, and that means you have that 10-to-1 ratio of gas to air to get that blue flame. And if you have orange and yellow, that means that the burner can either be dirty or that 10-to-1 ratio is off. And so I'm sitting there talking about flames about that time we had this big orange flame. So I was just kind of like, that's the orange flame you don't want to see. And, you know, I didn't even realize that it caught fire until I saw the faces because I was looking at my audience, the big eyes. You know, doing this. But things happen, and you just gotta take a deep breath and go on. But so, you know, remember that things are unexpected, things are gonna happen, and sometimes it actually, well, in this case, it didn't make the audience relax more because we had the actual fire. But sometimes when you mess up or if you spill something, I mean, I've had times where I've spilled something before, sometimes it actually makes your audience relax more because it's like, oh, they're human, you know, because they'll look up here and they're like, oh, this is like a June Cleaver presentation. Everything's perfect, and, you know, everything's set up just right. And at home, it usually doesn't work that way. So, and I do things different here than I do at home also. So if you do mess up, you know, you just got to make light of it and go on and take a deep breath and just keep going because we're all human and everybody has their embarrassing moments. So just get it. You'll have something to say when somebody asks you what your most embarrassing moment is. all the nerves, because the more you practice, the more familiar you are with your topic, and the more comfortable you're going to be if something does take longer to cook. And that's another thing, you always want to prepare more information or more of that chatter than what you really need, because more likely than not, things are going to take longer to prepare than what you expect. So, you know, if something cooks a lot faster, then that's fine, and you can move on. You don't have to talk about it in a single little detail, because you don't want to bore your audience either. But if it takes longer to cook, then you actually have the information there, so you have something to say, and you're not just standing there with that awkward silence. Practicing in front of a video camera, like we're doing, this isn't really a practice, but it really is a good technique, because it does make you look at yourself. Some people have habits of playing with their hair, twirling their hair, or playing with necklaces, or other little habits that they don't even realize they're doing until they actually see themselves on camera. And there's nothing like seeing yourself on camera but doing, having a little habit like that, that most likely going to correct that habit, because after you see yourself do it, think, oh, I didn't know I did that. So, or, you know, you can play with bracelets or whatever. So, but mark yourself on camera. The other thing that it helps is with your speech. And one of my biggest things is that I tend to get up a lot. Now I'm going to make myself really self-conscious. You guys are going to start yelling every time I say it, you're going to know. But that was something I really had to work on, and I didn't realize how much I said that until I actually saw myself on camera. And I had to realize that it's okay to pause and have a moment of silence. I think a lot of us tend to think when we do a presentation, you've got to be up there talking and talking, because you're the show, you know, people are watching you. And so you think, oh, I can't pause, like, because if I'm quiet, then, you know, people are going to be bored, or they're going to lose interest, or whatever. But sometimes a pause is good, especially if you're trying to drive home a point, or if you have an important point to make. Pause after that. Take a deep breath. Let that point sink in with your audience, and then go on. So, make sure I'm not saying on. Anyway, a couple things about the assistant, if you are using the assistant for your program. Basically, you want your assistant to be invisible, because you are the one, you are the star of the show, you're the one that's trying to relate this information. So the assistant is there just to help you and to enhance your performance. So you want them to wear something more subtle. For instance, if, you know, like today I'm in a navy blue dress, I wouldn't want my assistant coming in some big floral red and yellow shirt, because she's definitely going to stand out more than I am. Or you don't want her to have a lot of jangly jewelry on. That's going to make a lot of noise. She needs to be, like, if there's water to be run or things to be mixed up, you know, you want to try to be as quiet as possible. Preferably, you don't turn the water on during a demonstration, because that's going to take away from the noise. The assistant should practice with you. And you always, if you're doing a food demo, really should try to do the practice at least once with food, because you may, when you write it down on paper, sometimes it's a lot different than when you actually demonstrate it. Something may take longer to cook than what you thought, or you may think you want to demonstrate something, and after you actually practice it and demonstrate it, you think, oh, well, people really don't want to see that. You know, for instance, you want to put a brown hamburger in front of somebody. Everybody knows how to brown brownies. So you don't want to demonstrate things that are going to either insult people or are going to be boring, as they already know. So show things that are new, or if there's something like, if you want to show like how to make a strawberry pan and do it in a garnish, one is sufficient. You don't have to make several of them. Even though on your final product you might be using three strawberry pans, just show them how to make one. You don't want to just keep repeating the same process over. That in mind too when you're demonstrating things. Because if think about the level of your audience also, sometimes it's hard to know where all your students are. But if you're, for instance, the dietitians, if they're presenting to other dietitians, you know, they know about certain health issues and that type of thing. So don't talk down to them. You know, don't tell them, okay, we're working with this carrot, and carrot is very high in beta carotene. And, you know, like, you know, everybody knows that if they're all dietitians. Now, if you're talking to just a general audience, you may say that, they talk about some of the benefits of beta carotene and why it's good. And some people may know, but a lot of people don't. But just so think about your audience and who you're talking to. Because, like I said, you don't want to insult their intelligence. Also, with the assistant, their eyes should be on you. Because, for two reasons, really. One, because you may have forgotten something, and they will recognize that if they're watching you and paying attention to you. And the other reason is because the audience is going to, they're going to see the people up here, and they're going to be looking around. And if your assistant is standing there over here doing this, pretty soon all the eyes are going to start, what is she looking at up there? And they're going to start looking around. So the assistant needs to be paying attention to you because they're going to, people are going to follow that line of vision. So she's looking at you, the audience is going to tend to look at you, and then like I said, too, she'll notice if you need something. So she needs to know your speech, or he needs to know your speech almost as well as you, so that she knows the timing of things, and also if you need something. Does anyone have any questions so far? I've been going through this thing and stopped to ask.
I have a question on the honest, but I tend to do that too. How did you get that out? I know you said, it's okay and have pauses, but how did you practice that out?
Saying it over and over and over. Just practicing my speech. I would practice maybe 6 to 10 times, I would say it. And just keep practicing and practicing. And then when you have, I actually had someone sit there to tell me for me one time. I mean, I saw myself on video, but my former manager, sat there one time and just made little tally marks, and when I saw that, I was like, oh my gosh, it really happened. So I have to make a real conscious effort not to say it. So you really have to think about it, and when you finish a thought or when you finish a sentence, make yourself just stop and just close your mouth for a second instead of just keep talking. So it's hard, and it just comes with practice. Just the more you say the speech, the more you practice it, the more comfortable you get, and the less likely you are to make grammatical errors or to add those little ums and ands and that type of thing. So it just comes with practice. And I still say it. I still catch myself saying it. It's probably something I'll never completely get rid of, but it just depends. It depends on the program and how comfortable I am with it. The more I practice, the less I tend to say it. The more I'm unpracticed, and we have a lot scheduled. I notice if I haven't had a chance to really practice as much as I want, if I tend to say it. So, and just say, even standing in front of a mirror, saying your speech in front of a mirror helps too. And it's a little more comfortable than the video. Because the video camera, you watch it back. I mean, video camera, though, does say a lot. Even though it isn't as comfortable as it is. But we used to, in college, we had to videotape our camera, and then we actually scheduled a meeting with our instructor, and we had to sit down and watch it together for the first time. Sounds like you guys get to at least see it by yourself first. That makes it a little nicer. So we actually sat down with the instructor and watched it together, and she was sitting there pointing out things, and you knew. I mean, as soon as you saw it, I can't believe I did that, or I can't believe I said that. So. You just, your video camera does help. As uncomfortable as it is. I'm going to keep getting those things.
You won't let me escape.
Okay. Let's see. Does anybody else have any questions? Yes.
I have a couple points. Be sure you all look at the trig hives and the task and chatter, because you need to do that in your demos in 2 weeks and then your second demo also, okay? So if you have any questions, be sure all of you have looked at those so you know what they are so you can duplicate that. And then also, if you have any questions about using an assistant, speak up now, because on your second demo you'll need to use an assistant. So, and you may, after you watch Becky do it, you may have a question after the program also. So be sure everybody looks at the cards so that you have in mind how to put that down and where to check your name.
Once you have everything together, you practice with your assistant, you kind of want to make a checklist for yourself too. Some of the other things that go into it, you know, you have to think about your, if you're doing a food preparation or even other types of demonstrations, there's always advanced things that have to be done. So you have to get your grocery list together, if you're serving samples, or if you're giving out, if you're doing some kind of craft item, and you're going to be giving out little samples to everybody or little kits to everyone, you know, you have to include all of that in your grocery list. For instance, the chocolate cherry cake that we're doing today, we have to have one made in advance because we need one for garnish, and then you have to have the ingredients also for your demo. So you have to think about those things. With our shrimp teriyaki, that's marinated shrimp. So we had to get extra shrimp because we had to have some marinated already. So you could kind of make a timeline for yourself too, that, okay, the night before I have to have this cake made, shrimp marinated, or either that morning if it's an evening presentation, however you want to make that timeline. Then you do, you have to set up your trays, check your equipment, make sure we had one program 5 minutes before the program, we didn't check our cooktop, and the burners went light. And so, luckily with gas, you can actually, if the electric is out, you can, that's another advantage of gas, is that you can actually light the burners with a match or a butane lighter, so you can still cook with it. And what we found out later, we went ahead and lit the burner with a little match, and what we found out later, they were, had been working up here, and they had unplugged the cooktop because of whatever they were working on. And this one had the spark ignition or the automatic ignition, so it needed the electricity for that spark ignition. So it was just a matter of, we also went ahead too, was plugged the thing back in, but you know, it was like, oh my gosh, we're gonna start this presentation, what am I gonna do? The cooktop doesn't work. So check your equipment beforehand. Don't wait till 5 minutes before the presentation. And then with audiovisual equipment, have an extra light bulb if it slides. A lot of people don't use slides anymore, but have extension cords on hand. Keep one in the trunk of your car if you're one that, but yes, if you end up with a job that you do a lot of presentations, you know, keep an extension cord in the trunk so you have one on hand. Most companies have them for you, but just in case. So check all those things. Check your food, your garnishes, your displays, whatever you're going to be demonstrating. Then the last thing you want to do is check yourself. And I know that sounds kind of funny, but make sure you go by, look in the mirror, because I know all of you have been in a class or a seminar or somewhere where somebody either has a zipper down, a butt undone, or food in their teeth, something, and the whole time you're thinking, gosh, I know that. And you know, you're concentrating on that, and it distracts you from what they're saying. So you want to try to keep the focus on your speech, because you're out there to make an important point. So check yourself and make sure that you don't have lipstick on your teeth or whatever. So do that. And then the last thing really is to take a deep breath and try to relax. And just remember, things do go wrong, but you don't have to panic. And we'll have butterflies. I still get butterflies before programs, and I've been doing this for 9 years. But after time, you just learn how to control those butterflies. So, like I said, things go wrong, but you will be fine. You just have to practice, and the more you practice, the more perfect you will be. So, any questions? Okay, well, let me check back here with Janelle, and then we will get started on the actual presentation.
Thank you very much.